Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I've been asked to give you a plenary lecture, and it's a bit difficult to have such a wide variety of backgrounds and levels of knowledge and specialization. So I thought what I would do is that I will, the core of my presentation is actually the five recommendations of the Lancet Commission on Essential Medicines Policies on quality and regulatory support. But I've always also been asked to put this in a little bit in the wider perspective of access to essential medicines in general. So I'll start a little bit with that, and I'll also end a little bit with that, putting again what I said in the middle in a wider perspective. And I have a few personal slides also, which you can see as my contribution to the discussion later today. So here's the Lancet Commission report. It was a huge report, 75 pages. I brought it here with me. That has basically put, as I say, quality of medicines in a wider cadre. Very briefly, historically, you can see that when we talk about essential medicines, we have a first era of the 1970s to 1990s, when we had the first model list of WHO, the Alma-Ata conference, and the uptake of national essential medicines lists and national drug policies. That was the early years. And then after 1990, we have the second era, where we have growing complexity, more and more actors, Global Fund, many other international agencies, World Bank entering the field. So growing complexity, new global financing mechanisms, and then you see this recognition of medicines as part of health systems. And you get some additional focus on, for example, essential medicines for children and attention for expensive essential medicines, which were the newer things added in these two decades. And then now we are in the area, the third area from 2010, where we basically say essential medicines are an essential component of universal health coverage and an essential component of national health insurance. So here you see the well-known goals in the Sustainable Development Goals. Basically, you can see here, the first one is the problem, what I would call access to existing essential medicines. Medicines that exist, but people simply can't get them. And the second is support to research and development. That is what we call missing essential medicines. Essential medicines that are simply not being produced, not even developed. Now, here you have the Lancet Commission, not did most of it, and it was quite interesting when we spoke to Richard Horton, the editor of the Lancet, and we complained to him and said, listen, why does the Lancet publish so little about essential medicines? And then he said, is that so? And I said, yeah, that's really so. And he said, okay, well, I think because doctors are interested in products, and in patients, not in products. They like to think about patients, not about pills. And that is a very interesting thing, and that will come back, that many doctors think, and when you think about quality, that the key problem is I'm there as a doctor, I make the diagnosis, I spend a lot of time diagnosis, I do the treatment, and I send it, and that's the end of it. And the patient just goes and gets the medicine. And there's this huge pyramid of problems behind that moment that it is not so simple for the patient to get the medicine and to have it of a good quality. Now, here to remind you, again a slide, why essential medicines are also so important for the future. After 30 years, still, you can say this is my list of essential medicines, lack of access to existing essential medicines. We have the child deaths, 7 million children still die every year from diseases that can simply be averted by medicines, like pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria. They simply don't get the medicines. Only one-third of children with pneumonia is treated with an antibiotic. 30% of the women who are pregnant need some sort of medication for anemia, vitamins, can't get it. 225 million women want to use modern anticonception and can't get it. They simply can't, it's not there or too expensive or forbidden or not on the market. 10 million people with AIDS still need the medicine, and then the non-communicable diseases. This is really the problem of the next generation. The majority of people with non-communicable diseases are not diagnosed, and if diagnosed, not treated, and if they're treated, they stop the treatment. So huge, huge, huge lack of missing essential medicines. None of these medicines are very expensive, and none of them are on patent, and yet so many people can't get it. The second part of the problem, the missing essential medicines, here's just, you can read it. Can you read from the back, actually, or is it difficult to read from the back? You can read from the back, so I don't have to repeat everything that's on the slides. But you can see here some examples of what I call a missing essential medicines. Let's just call it a single encounter medicine for malaria. Even artisanated said you have to take for 3 days. Or a shorter treatment for tuberculosis is not there. Neglected diseases, we all know. New antibiotics. I should mention that. I mean, let's say, why are so few antibiotics being developed? Basically because antibiotics is bad business. Vaccines are bad business for the pharmaceutical industry. You produce a vaccine, you sell one, and you lose a customer. Basically, then, for the antibiotics, the same thing. You sell it for 1 week, patient never comes back. What's good business is chronic diseases. That is good business. And what is even the best business is presumptive treatment, like, oh, you may have pre-diabetes. You better start treating because it may, that's sort of stuff. That's good business. So an antibiotic is bad business, and nobody is really from the market is not going to do that. And one key point in the Lancet Commission was also, if you say the market is not developing antibiotics, because that's basically the case, that's a market failure. No. It's a policy failure. It's a policy failure to rely on the market to do it. You have to accept that the market will not do it. The market is right. The market says this is not a good investment. So if you want antibiotics, you pay for it. Now, Debbie, you also make the list of that you need better formulations. Fixed-dose combinations for children, dispersible tablets for amoxicillin, heat-stable insulin, nobody bothers, and, for example, very small dosages for children. So you need new medicines, but you also need new formulations of some medicines. Now, going back to the Lancet, here comes the big kader. We spent a lot of time in the commission to find out what is the real problem, and in the end, in access to medicines, looking at the last 30 years. And we basically came to 5 big problems. Paying for a basket of essential medicines is problem number 1. Lack of access to existing medicines. Then making essential medicines affordable, anything dealing with prices and with these expensive new essential medicines. I can't go into it. Then assuring the quality and safety of the medicines. I'll go into that one. Promoting quality use, rational use, quality use, good quality use, scientifically sound and effective use that prevents economic loss and ensures the best health outcomes. And then developing the missing essential medicines. And finally, point 6, which is overarching, a good monitoring system. I can't go into that, but that's what we actually, the Commission is still now starting new discussions with the WHO on measuring access, a global measuring system comparable to, for example, the Safe Motherhood and Mother to Child roadmap and countdown mechanism, or the good mechanisms for AIDS. They don't exist for medicines at all. So I can't go in all of these. I can do later in the discussion if you want to. But now you see that quality is one of 6 problems. And what you see here, there's some other problems which we simply didn't touch. The problem of traditional medicine, herbal medicines, which are totally unregulated. The problem of pure supply systems. There's many other things where we say, well, not saying it's not a problem, but more that so many other actors are already acting. We choose these as the 5 or 6 main problems. Let me touch about this. I'm coming back to access to existing essential medicines. For the first time ever, the Commission made an estimate, a real good estimate, what would it cost to supply 200 essential medicines to your population in a lower middle income country. And real, I mean, forget about the methodology, you can read it, beautifully constructed, and we come to, if you say you want 200 medicines, that's basically includes AIDS, TB, malaria, family planning, all the real, I mean, you can run a district hospital on 200 medicines, easily. What would it cost? And we come to anything between $13 and $25 per person per year. And for the poorest countries, it's about $13. Which doesn't go very badly with the World Bank estimate that you need $60 per person per year to run a primary care system. And about 1/4 of that is medicines. That all, it fits very well. So let's take the $13. Then we looked, and here this, you can't read the letters, that doesn't matter. But you can see the point. Every dot is a country, a low developing country. Here you see what they spend on health, and it runs till 60. Just for your comparison, I think a country like the Netherlands spends about 5 or 6 thousand per year per person on health, 60, 70. And then here, vertical, how much of that is on medicines? That runs till 20 in the top. And the big line here, the green line, is the $13 threshold. And now you see, and these are all the low-income countries, 75% of low-income countries spend less than $13 on medicines. And that's public and private together. So you see Haiti, Togo, Nepal, Mozambique, you see Rwanda, you can see most of them, three quarters, and one quarter of the low middle income countries spend less than $25. So you have a very, very structural lack of money, lack of expenditure on medicines. That's why people can't get the medicines. Now, let me bring you to Africa. I'm still happy to go there. By the way, you have saw my CV, but before that, before WHO, I was 5 years a mission doctor in India and Ghana. Later I went back to Ghana. Now, this is 2013. This is the district hospital near Tamale in northern Ghana. And let me see what... this is the waiting area. Where's the pharmacy? Okay, this is the pharmacy. It's a little window. And here you see the same window, and here behind is a young lady smiling and working very hard. This is the pharmacy. So from the window, she gives the medicines to the people. District hospital, 200 patients per day, something like that. Okay. This is 2 years later, Uganda, in northwestern Uganda, rural health center. This is people waiting. You see them waiting. This is the pharmacy. That's all. This is not a tray. This is what is in stock. And you can see here a few medicines and some generics and some packages. This is it. Now you can understand why so many people simply can't get even simple things. By the end of the month, there's nothing left, obviously. So you walk into the market. This is Nairobi Market. And this is where the lady says, oh, you have headache. Which one do you want, the red one or the blue one? That's basically, and then you say, no, I need tetracycline. She says, okay, here's the tetracycline. How many do you want? Oh, give me two. And with the scissors, she cuts the two capsules and gives you the two tetracycline. And next morning, you say, I'm still not fully better. Give me one more. And then you get one more. Half the medicine quantities is less than 10 capsules per time that you buy. It's like buying cigarettes from a box or sardines from a tin. That's how you buy your medicines. So why is quality assurance needed? So we can say the patients really cannot verify the quality, the safety, and the efficacy of medicine themselves. Since that's the public, even the pharmacist probably cannot, or only partially. So ensuring the quality is a real public function. Don't leave it to the market. Secondly, the risk for the patient. Poor quality medicines can cause serious fatal harm to patients. Money spent on poor quality medicines is wasted, and additional costs are incurred to counteract the harm. And of course, for society, poor quality medicines reduce health outcomes, endanger public health, and reduce public trust, as already said by the minister. So you really need quality assurance, and it's a public function. Now, I think many of you have seen, let me quote just some of the striking examples of lack of quality. So in 2008, 28% of the anti-malaria medicines in Cameroon, Ethiopia, Ghana, Kenya, and Nigeria were substandard. 11% of anti-tuberculosis medicines from Russian former states were deficient. Rifampicin, 28%, nearly one-third of the rifampicin-containing medicines, the rifampicin was not in it, or it was not absorbable. Then you have, of course, the dramatic incidents with the paracetamol and the cough syrup, with people dying from falsified and in Panama and Pakistan. Interesting, we and also WHO has looked at a lot of studies on substandard and falsified medicines, and most of them, 86% of these studies, focus on infectious diseases, communicable diseases. There's very few studies on the quality of non-communicable disease medicines, just for you to note. Okay. This is a lovely graph. I really like one of my favorites. This is on the quality of misoprostol in about 15 low and middle income countries. Every dot is a sample. And there's a lot of information here. First of all, you see horizontally, you see this is the time. 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. Some drugs have an expiry level of 2 years, some of 3 years. Okay, here you see the active ingredient. This is 100%, 110 and 90. So this is the band in which it is. So a medicine, depending on the active ingredient and the time since production, gets a dot. Now what you want is that medicines are here and nothing after expiry. So if a medicine is 2 years expiry, it should not be here. Okay, now you see the dots. And now you can't possibly see the D. But what you can see is that a huge number of medicines over time have lost their active ingredient. Probably unstable or it was never there. We see a few, five out of these never had anything in it. They were counterfeits. They were falsified medicines. Zero ingredient, but also zero, let me say, a product. If it's unstable, it moves it to something else. There was not even degradation product. So these were proper falsified medicines, zero content. You see, some manufacturers, they know their stuff is unstable. They overfeed. They already put too much in it, which is wrong as well. What you want is people. Then you see some products, all these products were, the black boxes are products which are pre-qualified by WHO. And now you see all the pre-qualified by WHO except one, where basically where you want them to be. But then there's even more information because then you could, so you can see first of all that a majority of medicines on the market were simply not good enough. And misoprostol, life-saving drug, as you know, for the prevention or treatment of bleeding postpartum. But now we can look here. If you split it up, then you can see these are four manufacturers. Now suddenly you see that one manufacturer was okay, this manufacturer was not okay, this was definitely not okay, and this one probably never even produced something good. Then also you have, there were some medicines which are in aluminium blisters or plastic blisters. Here you see, these are the ones which are in plastic blisters. And these were aluminium and plastic. So again, also the packing can be of enormous impact on the quality of the product. What I forgot to say is that when you look at this one, a huge majority of these products was never registered in the country where it was taken. So I think in Ghana, if I remember well, it was a study in Ghana where they had 28 samples and only 18 of the 28 were, only 8 out of 28 were registered in the country and 20 were never registered. And many, and then all the non-registered, all of them were substandard. So here you see a big, I call this an infograph. Here you can see really what's happening in countries. Now, what, as a commission, what do we say? And we had, as I said, in this section three, a number of recommendations for the regulators, because the regulators, it's a public function, so the regulators should be not responsible, should check the quality. So an important thing, the regulator is not responsible for the quality. The manufacturer is responsible for the quality. The regulator is responsible for checking it and checking compliance with the standards. Now, here you can see, this is the recommendations are technical and maybe a little bit boring, but this is the direction in which they go. And first of all, there's strong emphasis on international harmonization and regional collaboration. So don't repeat what's done, do things in a standardized way. That makes it easy for everybody, because there's too much work to be done. Then, this is the most important, redirect activities of the NMRA, the National Medicine Regulatory Authority, to those that add value. So don't, for example, don't repeat a product assessment. If it has been approved by the EMEA or approved by WHO, I would say basically it should be good enough. So don't repeat. And people would say, oh, national sovereignty, we want to decide for ourselves, responsible for our own market. Okay. But if that's all you're doing, then you're not doing enough. So less emphasis on national security, sovereignty, no repeat assessments, and focus on targeted enforcement. If you assess your dossiers and you never check whether anything that's in the pharmacies for sale is registered in the country, there's no point in assessing the dossier. So the market enforcement is the real, that adds value. Repeating an assessment does not add value. Now, then, involve other stakeholders and the general public in the quality assurance through new technologies. There are so many things with barcodes and things like that. You have telephones, people can report bad quality. There is a new function where you can involve the public. Then you promote transparency of information, for example, the outcome of assessment and inspections. For example, if a government takes a sample from a pharmacy and says medicine so-and-so from manufacturer so-and-so is bad quality, that's hardly ever published. And even now, I think it's only the Global Fund that publicly publishes the assessment, the quality reports. I hope it's better. Maybe I'm a little bit out of date on this one. But in any case, many people say, oh, no, we don't want to publish. And maybe we get a court case from the factory. It says, you're accusing me. And many regulators say, okay, we don't publish the results. But then the public doesn't know that this is a bad medicine, or donors don't know. And then also one thing that's very missing in most regulators, promote accountability through independent assessment of the performance of the NMRAs. How are you performing? Is that publicly checkable? How is the regulatory agency actually performing? So international collaboration, do what adds value, that's focus on target enforcement, involve other stakeholders and the public, be transparent about what you're doing, and be accountable for what you're doing. These are the directions of the regulatory agency of the future. Now, let me just say a few things on each of these five ones. Regulator harmonization. So there is now an international standard regulator dossier. Use an international dossier. Use a standard dossier. Don't say in Uganda that, okay, we need additional studies on Ugandan citizens. Forget about that. Or we need additional toxicology. Forget about it. Have a standard dossier that's the same for everybody. And we then softly say, this WHO dossier is a good example. With the international harmonization. Then, and promote the use of electronic dossiers so that you can share them easily and you can share also the assessment. More international collaboration and prevent repeat assessments that do not add a value. I always keep saying that already 10 years ago, the following governments basically said, we're not going to do repeat assessments. Canada, Switzerland, Singapore, and New Zealand. They don't repeat anything that has already been evaluated by the EMEA or by FDA. They only would check, is there anything specific that's important for my country, like the language or specific ethnic group, something like that. They don't repeat. So if Switzerland and New Zealand have decided not to repeat an assessment, why would you sit in your African country and repeat an assessment? Forget about it. That's not a good use of your time. Okay. The second one, evolve the WHO UN pre-qualification program. And there we basically say WHO should evolve the pre-qualification to maintain a moving focus on new essential medicines. For ARVs, I think it has achieved its goal. It's a mature market. But for insulin, or for snake venom, I can think of a new drugs or hepatitis C medicines, which are complex molecules and which are not so many products and regulators find it difficult. Do that now by pre-qualification. Use it as an example. Forget about the ones that everybody can do themselves now. So focus on new essential medicines and those with regulatory challenges like human insulin and biosimilars. And then the PQ standards and the assessment reports and the inspection reports should form the basis for regulatory convergence and mutual recognition. If the dossier was approved by WHO pre-qualification and the company submits the same medicine and the same dossier to a country, then that regulator should basically use that as the basis for their decision. And then, of course, WHO, this is such an important public function that sustainable financial basis must be created, not just Unitaid and the Bill Gates Foundation. I think if we see this as a real public good, and I think it is, and there's no WHO staff here, and not many government people, but basically WHO has become supranational. It was international with advisory, but with the pre-qualification program, WHO has softly taken a supranational function, which is basically a global public good, needs to be supported. Now, then better quality assurance in procurement agencies. Here you see the good example of MEDS in Kenya, where they started to check the quality of the incoming goods. And you see here, this was their own. So over time, they have zero failures now because the manufacturers know. You know the manufacturers know their customers. They have quality A and quality B, and probably even quality C. And if they know you are really checking, they will send you quality A. If they know you're not checking, you get quality B. You get a third shift, which they make in the evening, with second-rate raw materials, because they know you're not checking. So that's why when you start checking, you always have failures, something like here, 20% failures, 15, but now. then Metz, Wilbert, I think you know better, I think this is what happened. Metz, as a good laboratory, was also asked to check government-procured medicines for them. That's the red line. And you see, the government, they got a worse, much worse deal, government of Kenya, than Metz. Huh? So, but then also, when the manufacturers knew, and now you see, also the government, because the manufacturers know that the government is checking, and then you get quality A. Otherwise, you don't. Okay. Now, then again, redirect activities of the national regulatory agency to those that add value. So these are some essential functions that are often lacking. International harmonization, a single NMRA within a country. I mean, we have India with 39 different agencies. Each province has one. China has also, I don't know how many. If there's not, and India, for example, the problem is that a state-level agency can approve not imported medicines. That has to be done by India, Delhi. But it can approve the medicines produced in that state. And even if it's a bad medicine and a badly controlled, there's free trade within India. And other states cannot stop that one produced in that one single state. Now, that is a horror. That's one of the reasons why quality in medicines in India is so badly assured, because they have, as I say, 32 or something like that, different regulated agencies, and not all of them good. Now, the inspections and enforcements that has to be done. Assessment of new for neglected in their jurisdiction. That's very interesting. If you now have a new malaria drug or a new sleeping sickness drug, there's no real point in Europe. Probably it's not going to be important in Europe because you don't have that disease, or FDA will not touch it. So it's very important the assessment of a new medicine for a neglected tropical disease is done in, or at least with, the national authorities in that country, especially because you want to add the pharmacovigilance to it. Because there's no point in checking pharmacovigilance on sleeping sickness in Holland, because it's not there. So in Holland, you have a good system, but no patients. And maybe in Mali or Cameroon, you have the patients and no good system. So that is where the pharmacovigilance is really important. The pharmacovigilance for the diseases that are only in those areas. That needs to be supported. General pharmacovigilance on side effects of hypertension drugs, I don't believe. Africa is not going to add something. But on those specific tropical diseases, it's the only place where you can do it. So help them to do it. So targeted pharmacovigilance. Probably, what I said, with patient cohort, not just plain self-reporting. No, follow the patients, active cohort monitoring. That would be the way forward. Regulation of medicine promotion, of course, is still a big problem in many African countries. Many countries, by the way, but I mean, it's total freedom, total jungle there. And transparent reporting on the prevalence of substandard medicines. I think that's coming now with the central reporting system by WHO. Okay, let me share you this. Here you have an Instagram from Kim Kardashian, and she promoted, she basically, you can't read, she said, well, I was pregnant, and I was feeling so miserable in the morning, and I was vomiting all over, and then I took this medicine, and it was so much better, and the next morning I was vomiting again, and then so I took the medicine again, and it worked again, and it has been so wonderful, and in this little, she mentions the medicine 4 times. Now, and of course, this was seen by 42 million followers. This is advertising. So by the time the FDA ordered the manufacturer to remove that thing, on the grounds it was false or misleading, it was a medicine which was not basically proven at all. By the time the decision was reached, the post had received nearly 500,000 likes and 11,000 comments. This is the new way of advertising. This is the 21st century. So what are the regulators going to do about this? Just want to make you aware of it. So engage the public and other stakeholders. You have to involve the patient and stakeholders also in the regulatory decisions. That's more and more will be necessary. You can use them to check the product quality at the point of sale. For example, the unique barcodes. I believe strongly in unique barcodes. You have a pocket. This is a medicine in it. There's a barcode. And the moment you sell it or you buy it, it's scanned. Unique, not only for the medicine, but for this package. Centrally, it has been registered, medicine is sold. You can photocopy the barcode on another falsified medicine, but the moment you start, it's sure that that thing has already been sold. And that is the way forward. And I think there's a European directive in that direction. I believe strongly in to do that in targeted expensive medicines, or what was mentioned this morning, for example, in new, very valuable antibiotics, in the sofosbuvirs and things like that, which are new medicines which you don't, which you want to use. They're expensive. They're immediate candidates for falsification. That's why you have to block that by unique barcodes, in my opinion. And then you have other technical devices linked to smartphones and the internet. Huh? And encourage the public to report suspected products or advertisements and act on them. So as a regulator, you have to open yourself up to what the public says, not say the public is stupid or this is colored information or conflict of interest. Okay, in this case, I think you have to sift what you get, but you can use it as a watchdog function. Okay, and now on accountability, we also worked a lot, and I like this much. This is again one of our lines. The accountability, if the national regulator fulfills an essential public function, which it is, the market is not going to do it, and is paid from public means, largely, hopefully, then accountability is in place. And is it really doing what it has to do and what it is being paid to do? And here are examples of indicators. And I like that because when you tell the regulators what you are measuring, you basically tell them what you want them to do. It's a wish list as well. And I think there's Belgian regulators here, there's Madagascar, Mali, maybe others. Check for yourself mentally, are you doing this or not? This is not the ideal, but this is a vision of the future. First of all, is there a public regulatory website where you find all the laws and all the approved products? And is it up to date? Well, good luck to you. I would be interested to see how many African countries where you can check on the web, is the medicine registered or not? In the Ghana, the 28 misoprostols, could you ever find out whether it was registered or not? Uh-huh. Then, the product applications and the assessment dossiers are published. If I want to say that medicine has been registered in this country, can I please see on what grounds? Where is the proof of effectiveness and proof of safety? Uh-huh. I think only there's a few that do that. Do we have regulatory committees with patient representation? Not in many countries. Are the inspections performed? So the number of inspections performed, and are the inspection reports published? Usually not. Are the domestic manufacturers supported in achieving GMP, or are they only inspected? Or is there basically a support program with a stepwise approach, et cetera, et cetera? Is that available? Is it public? Do you do risk-based surveys and samples? Huh? So are you, for example, saying, okay, these new antibiotics, are you actually sampling from the market or not? And are you publishing the results? Then, how many pharmacovigilance reports are you collecting and have you submitted them to the Uppsala Monitoring Center? Mm-hmm. There's very few from developing countries coming. Then, are you regulating the products intended for export? We just heard this morning that Belgium is in Europe the only one. We can complain about bad quality medicines from India, bad quality medicines from China. Yeah, you're not checking the quality of your products for exportation. Okay, in the Netherlands, I cannot complain because I don't do it myself. Yeah, so are you actually doing that? And many countries, most countries, don't. And then absence of legal obligations of TRIPS Plus. Is your law so that, for example, that patent status is not going to be checked by the regulators? Have you got good laws on data exclusivity? Is it not so that your data exclusivity laws are actually blocking compulsory license? Because you can have a license, but if the data cannot be used. So again, have you got all the relevant TRIPS Plus facilities in your law? And have you got any of the TRIPS Plus blocking things not in your law? All right, 10 points. If you get 1 point for each of them, I think many regulators will score between 0 and 3. Honestly. So this is basically the regulatory agency of the future. A brief one. I still have some time. Huh? A brief one on you can think about. Now, just some scenario. Now, we're entering my personal area. The Public Medicine Procurement Agency in Uganda, totally hypothetical country, issues a tender for an essential antiretroviral medicines, and a company wins the tender, the cheapest, but the product is not registered. What should now the government do? Do you still buy that because it's the cheapest? Or you refuse? Now, most people would say, well, it's either they should have never allowed a tender to include products which are not registered, or if that's the case, sometimes it's difficult, then you have at least had a quick notification procedure that at least the product is notified to the regulators, okay, it's available in the public sector or not. But this is already tricky, and this happens a lot in the countries. Second, a medicine importer can buy an antiretroviral medicine combination from India at a very good price and wants to import it into Uganda. But the product is not registered for sale in the country. The product arrives by air in Entebbe. What should the regulator do? Well, I think again, you will probably say, this is not registered, importation is illegal. Either you send it back or you confiscate the thing. But you don't allow it on the market because it was not registered before. You okay? A hospital receives a donation of AAV combination therapy from Belgium, but is not registered in the country. What should the regulator do? And this happens so often. Medicines collected, insulin, other things, medicines, and we send it to the mission hospital there. And 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, when I was in the mission hospital, we received a lot of that, and of course we took it, and nobody bothered. But now regulators increasingly say, hold on, this is not possible. As a donor, you have to respect the regulatory environment. And still, I'm involved in another hat in an insulin project, where you have still donated insulin from Australia and from America, which is insulin which was used by the patient, given back to the pharmacy because it was not used, and then shipped. That, in Europe, you would never be allowed to sell it. No, we ship it. Life-saving drug. And then they get it, and it's a different strength. It's a product that's not registered in the market, and it's a real problem. And these are structural things. So I just want to bring this to your attention here. Now I go, this was all quality. Now I end up by going wide again, the total picture. This is 2006, a real picture of a real woman with a real child in a real clinic in 2006, a photograph by Noah Cranswick. This was the lady, this was a sick child, and this is the prescription, that's what the child got. Can you imagine? All these meds, the monster pills here, the poor child is not even 2 years old. This is what it got. Uh-huh. So that made WHO go into this project for essential medicines for children. And here, a survey of children, these were problems with children's formulations. And you can see here, lack of PDF, so artemisinin derivatives at that time were only in tablet form for small children. No pediatric dose for combination tablets for TB. No pediatric HIV/AIDS medicines. Formulations, combination, very expensive. So there was a lot of problems with medicines for children. And this is the slide what I want to show you. Then we said, okay, let's make an essential drugs list for children. And let's take now the missing essential medicines have to come to market. Because the medicines for children was an interesting thing. It was a list of essential medicines for children. But it also identified the missing essential medicines for children. Or the ones which were there, but let's now take zinc. Zinc in combination with oral rehydration. Let's take this one. Okay, we need more zinc. All right, now, this is the problem. And we had a joint problem with WHO. The selection, so WHO model list of essential medicines for children. Zinc is on the list. But that doesn't mean zinc is in the country. So then WHO had new evidence on the efficacy, dose, and safety of the zinc. How much zinc? Why? That has to be published somewhere. Then we had developed global quality standards for zinc tablets because that was not part of the international pharmacopoeia. And zinc was only produced in a few countries like Bangladesh, but there was no quality standards. So even if you have other companies starting to do it, they couldn't check the quality. And the regulator had nothing to compare with. So as a first step, you need global quality standards. Then you can support the industry to develop better formulations. WHO, UNICEF can do that. But then, you need a mechanism to endorse the good quality. So that's where the pre-qualification comes in. You have to say, okay, this product from this manufacturer from China or Bangladesh with zinc is a good product. Okay. Then with that the pre-qualification dossier, you can try to promote rapid regulatory approval because it was not yet approved in Uganda nor in any of the African countries. So then you need to support the regulators to look at the dossier for zinc from that particular product to allow it on the market. And then you have to say, okay, and now the World Bank or Global Fund or UNITAID have to start funding for the medicine, otherwise it will never come. So many agencies. But then you can import zinc into Uganda, but if the doctors don't know it, they're not going to prescribe it. So you have the new evidence on efficacy, dose, and safety. That basically means this has to come now into WHO children's formulary. That's the global basis. Then in any country, including Uganda or wherever, you have to update the treatment guidelines. First, the WHO treatment guidelines, and then you have to promote the inclusion of national lists. So WHO has to work with each of these countries to encourage them to put zinc on their list of essential medicines. And then UNICEF has to give national advocacy and training because the doctors will have to prescribe it. Now, and then in the end, the medicine is available, good quality, endorsed, registered, paid, included in a treatment guideline, and people have been trained to use it. Now, this is a huge, complex project where you need so many actors and so many agents. Yeah, I just wanted to show you how it's how these sort of things work. And one example that is still not, I mean, after 20 years, is the prevention of eclampsia. Eclampsia, where you want for people to give magnesium sulfate rather than Valium. Diazepam. And still after 20 years, half the gynecologists said, no, we'll give diazepam and don't use the Maxelf. After 20 years. So the zinc still has a long way to go. Now, here, this is from my time at WHO. There's nobody from WHO here, huh? So I can safely speak. No. I'm not speaking on behalf of WHO. Let me make it very, very, very clear. This is how we worked in the essential medicines department. The usual thing was WHO works with the regional offices, country offices, Ministry of Health, to the national programs. But then you very often you want to work outside the Ministry of Health. The first thing is you want to work with NGOs, academia, which is not always encouraged by the Ministry of Health. They want WHO only for them. So you have the regulatory agency, the insurance, the collaborating centers, universities, the missions, the NGOs, the consumers. Country offices are not always allowed to do that, but we in WHO, we always said, it's easier to get forgiveness than it is to get permission. So you just do it, and if people complain, we'll hear about it. So don't ask for permission, just do it. So directly to the regulators, the insurance, and everybody else. But then we also, if you now take quality standards for antiretrovirals, let's take that one, or malaria medicines. Okay, that of course would go to the WHO departments, HIV, malaria, TB, they would have their channels also. But then, through the international interagency pharmaceutical coordination, we were very close with UNICEF, UNH, UNFPA, World Bank, etc. They would all accept pre-qualification, WHO standards. They would have their content. And then, of course, the NGOs, MSF, HI, MSH, GSI, all of these ones, IFPB, everybody would look at them. So this was a core and still is a core function. And I really believe, and that I can speak now as an outsider to anybody who has money, support WHO, because it is really a global function that works with so many lines through all the other agencies. And it's really of benefit to all. Now, a few slides and then I stop. What does it now mean? And this, again, is personal, so you may attack me on this. This is also where we can move into the discussion later this afternoon. When you have now donors, and we talk about quality assurance, let's first think about medicine donations. If you donate medicines, and I know there's a lot of good work being done, so don't see this as an attack or a blame. That's not the idea. But the core point is respect the interagency guidelines for medicine donations. So the core components are donate what is needed, not what you want to donate. It's a core principle. If you have surplus insulin, don't donate it because you want to get rid of it. Follow what the recipient wants. Respect the national regulatory system. Respect the national essential medicines list. No double standards in quality, so no return drugs, that sort of stuff. And relate the donational value to international non-profit generic prices. Now, you know all of that. I would now say focus on medicines with pre-qualification or registration by stringent authority and make long-term commitments. No incidental donations. It's a pain in the neck. And when you talk about technical assistance, I would say provide technical assistance to the national regulator agency in line with WHO guidelines. It's being done, largely being done. Do not donate written off laboratory equipment. Respect the WHO and EPN guidelines for donations, because that creates such problems. Support training opportunities for national regulators, for example, at stringent authorities or at WHO. And give financial support to WHO regulator support program. And it has a lot of training and attachment possibilities, WHO PreQ, etc. And this is really something of the present, but also the future. WHO is now increasingly organizing joint assessments, basically saying, okay, new antimalarial drug. There's one dossier, has been reviewed by pre-qualification, and then there's a meeting with 15 or 20 or 25 African countries, regulators. They come together, and in one afternoon or one day, whatever, they go through that dossier together. They do the assessment jointly, not a decision. They do the assessment together, and all the regulators learn, and they fly back to their country, and basically, this one has been assessed and approved. And they, so the decision still, it's not joint decision-making, but it's joint assessment. So they look at the facts, and of course, this is, first of all, very practical. The company gets a registration in 10 or 20 countries at the same time. It's a joint dossier, and the regulators learn a lot. And this works especially for neglected diseases and the new medicines for the HTB, malaria, etc., or the insulin biosimilars, these difficult products where the regulators really don't know. There's not much experience with them. Okay, so that's that. Saving lives with the right to essential medicines. Thank you very much indeed.